The only thing that can really pull the head down is the muscles attached to this bone. Because the attachments, they go from the chin to this bone, in turn then go to the sternum, that's the beginning of the rib cage. And when you contract all of those muscles in a row, that means the hyoid being caught in the middle between those muscles is going to be responsible for bringing the whole head down. So if the animal keeps its jaw closed and then contracts those muscles, instead of opening the jaw, it's going to depress the head. And that's the beginning of the body wave that these animals use to swim. So that makes this bone a bone that's involved in swimming. And that's unusual, because here's an animal that's locomoting with its throat.
Joy's research is turning the science of how whales swim on its head. By studying a bone crucial to communication, she unwittingly stumbled across an explanation of how they learned to swim. The fin whale is the greyhound of the sea. Its streamlined body crosses oceans from the subtropics to its feeding grounds nearer the poles. But in the case of this whale, something went wrong when it came to feed off the coast of Ireland. Now that the tide's receded, there are only 4 more hours left to solve the mystery. The preliminary evidence suggests this whale was sick. But Joy wants to rule out another possibility, that it was hit by a ship.
Boat strikes tend to be marks that go this way. So I'm looking for a big area that looks like it's been hit this way. This is a possibility, right here. Unless they did it with that scraper. I have to ask them, because this looks very fresh. This is an old injury that's healed up. You can see that the skin is absolutely smooth here, but you see color differences. They don't match up. So this animal had a gash here. Could have been a shark bite. Could have been maybe a boat propeller. So that's not the cause of this problem, but it's an old injury. Oh, yes! Thank you. There's a scrape on the side in the blubber there that's in a vertical line that we think might have been caused by the excavator.
Yeah,
we want to make sure. It was.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good.
Because
that rules out one of the possible causes.
We were tornado over.
Okay.
So we don't...
So that made that strike.
Yeah.
So that takes care of us figuring out what that line's from. Thank you.
The sheer size of whales makes them invincible to most predators. These lumbering giants have only one major enemy, us. Centuries of intensive whale hunting have seen their numbers plummet throughout the world. One species, the right whale, was particularly favored by whalers because it's so slow. It's how they got their name. They were the right whales to hunt. Because they're faster, fin whales have always been harder to catch. But their size and feeding behavior make them most vulnerable to ship strikes.
There are no other wounds that you've seen on this side now.
Just parasite wounds and small things.
After inspecting the side of the whale, Joy now rules out a ship strike. She needs to look for another cause of death. This fin whale is a young adult, and Joy wants to check whether it's carrying a calf. First, she needs to find the reproductive organs.
But somewhere in this big clunk of tissue, I think we're going to be seeing the ovary. It would be an oval-shaped structure, probably about that big. I was hoping it would be in here. This just seems to be fat as far as I can tell. So I'm going to keep looking.
The anatomy of whale sex is extraordinary. Males can have penises up to 3 meters long and testicles that can weigh a ton. They have to be stored internally to minimize drag. Joy can find no evidence that this whale is pregnant. But back in her lab in New York, she has a fin whale fetus from another post-mortem.
And we can see the front of the animal's head right here. If we open the mouth, and we can because it's so flexible, because the bone is still cartilage, it hasn't turned to bone yet, this is all cartilage in here. We're bending open the mouth, and we see this, is the tongue. And these ridges are where the baleen would develop. And the animal is folded quite compactly inside the womb, like this, in a very compact, streamlined form, just like that, all folded together. And when the mother delivers the baby, you usually deliver them tail first, so the animal doesn't take a breath until it's actually outside the mother. And then after it's born, it will swim to the surface and take its first breath through the nostrils, which are on the top of its head.
After taking a breath, some whales can stay underwater for half an hour or more before returning to the surface. Their lungs have adapted to refresh up to 90% of their air with one exhalation.
Dean, can you send me over there? Send me over to my mini digger.
Now Joy wants to reach the lungs and heart in the last remaining hours before the tide comes in.
How confident are you that we're going to be able to get into the chest cavity?
I keep my spirits up. I think we can do it.
The heart and lungs are encased inside the whale's vast ribcage. But a local village wants to preserve the skeleton, so Joy can't saw through the ribs as originally planned. Instead, she must dive under the ribcage to try to release the organs.
Where have your legs gone?
God, don't even ask. This is the aorta, and this is the major blood vessel that's carrying blood from the heart down through the rest of the body.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? You're doing a post-mortem and a dissection where on the one hand you're using tweezers and on the other hand you're having to do it with a huge great digger. It's that kind of job. You can see the lung there, the very pink tissue that's just prolapsed out through the diaphragm, which is the big muscular sheet between your abdomen and your thorax. She's now trying to work through the diaphragm to be able to get both lungs out and particularly to look at the heart. And that's a really fascinating thing from my point of view because it is a mammalian heart. Is it exactly the standard design of all the mammals that I normally work with? But even amongst the experts, there's quite a debate about exactly how big it is. But when you see the size of the blood vessels just in the gut, in the mesentery, with this size, you need a big pump to be able to get blood around there. So hopefully in the next half an hour or so, we'll be able to have a look.
Right in here where my hand is reaching, that's the heart. So I can feel it, but it's so large I can't pull it out until I can free the top, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to get in there deep enough to do that. But I'm still trying.
The heart's held in place by massive blood vessels, which are just too deep inside for Joy to reach.
At the top of the heart's too far up to cut those. The only way we're going to get that is if we cut the ribs now. It's too much. But I can tell you